Yep.
Everyone's well, I hope. Dave?
Doing quite well, hanging in there. How about yourself?
Thank you. Doing fine. Yep. I'm in New Jersey. My wife is just starting to teach, and she's Zooming, of course. Okay.
Wow.
Well, we have
what
a
does she teach?
She teaches English, classical English, and writing.
At a university or school?
University of St. Elizabeth University in Morristown. And she's just starting today, and they're Zooming for a while. Okay, so Kathy, thank you for joining.
Yeah, glad I can make it.
Yeah, okay.
Hi, Kathy.
Hi, how are you?
Great. And here's Kathy.
And pardon me?
No, nothing. Yeah.
Oh, okay. And Andrew, I know I've seen you on the social media several times, so thank you for joining us.
Glad to be here.
And Joan, we hope to keep this meeting very brief, and then we have bylaws just to go over very briefly, and then we'll open it up for any comment after that. I don't know whether we have one other person, Christy, said she's going to join us. That's very good. All right, we'll start the meeting officially. This is the Citywide Neighborhood Committee on August 26th, 2020. This is more or less an administrative meeting. However, we will hear several reports on what's going on forums and National Night Out, and of course, be very open to any urgent issues before we adjourn. So I can see we have a quorum here among those of us who are on the committee. And for the rest of you folks, thank you very much for joining. It's always a pleasure. We don't have anybody else. We were hoping for one of the police officers to come, but I'll cover that when we get to the agenda item. For our committee members who have looked at the agenda, at the bylaws, does anyone have any specific changes that they wish to make at this time?
No, but I have a question.
Sure.
So the thing that Paul sent, that little blurb of a paragraph.
Yes.
He keeps mentioning that he wants it as an independent from City Hall. And that he joined the committee because he liked the independence. I'm just going to be honest. I joined the committee because I like being a part of the city. And well, I'm not quite sure what that means to be independent.
Well, of course, Paul wrote that on his own, and that was his view.
Okay.
But I was more.
I didn't know if that was getting included in anything.
No, not in the bylaws. We are still very much part of the city.
Okay.
We don't have an active neighborhood agenda yet. And at some point I would like to, if there was an active neighborhood agenda where we had major issues that the committee could deal with for specific neighborhoods or complaints that affect more than one neighborhood, this would be certainly an ideal. And then the forums and the National Night Out would be a secondary thing. But it's not true. We're not there yet. We're not independent yet, and I don't intend to, as far as I'm concerned, I don't plan to be independent from the city for some time until the neighborhoods either have serious problems within the neighborhoods that need to be addressed, or therefore they may have grievances against the city, which is probably the only reason why one would want to be independent. If they did have a grievance against the city, then it would be something that we'd have to address very carefully, but we would address it. You know, aside from that, it's going to be business as usual, except I hope that we can get the pass these new bylaws or the changes in the bylaws so that we can address individual neighborhood problems too.
So can I just say something else too?
Sure.
So I've been pretty candid that I just think that it's premature to do anything to change the bylaws. I think we just need to live our life as a committee and do things. And I'm not quite sure, like what would you like to do that we can't do because of what the bylaws say?
The bylaws are very clear about the fact that we do not have any association with individual neighborhood issues. And this was something that I made very clear that I would like to go forward and address individual neighborhood issues, such as parking and noise and things like that, as long as the bylaws state now, they don't conflict with other neighborhood problems. Some of these things are very, one has to be very careful how you deal with that, but nevertheless, I was very frustrated that we really couldn't get into specific neighborhood issues, and they're out there, and they're sitting out there, and so this is why Paul and I have been working to make that at least a basic change in the bylaws itself.
I'm just not sure. It must say someplace. It says for the greater good of the city and its neighborhoods as a whole.
Yes.
Rather than individual neighborhoods and their respective particular issues.
It's the vision statement that is probably the most important. And let's see if I can get this up or not. Let's see if I can share that.
Advocate that neighborhoods have a voice in all matters affecting the quality of life within the neighborhoods.
Well, that's true. I don't have it right here right now, but oops.
It seems like we should just live our best life as a committee, and I'm not sure what you can't do because.
Never mind. No. It doesn't affect that at all. If you read the vision statement, part A. It says, and I'll read, advocate for the greater good of the city and its neighborhoods as a whole, as well as, which is the change.
Well, that's what you're adding, right?
Yeah. Individual neighborhoods and their prospective particular issues. Okay, that's it. That is a very important change because the rather than that's done in red that I sent both all of you, that just says that it confines us to general issues and not particular issues of any neighborhood. And this is one reason why I wanted to continue this, and Paul did too.
What about B?
I'm sorry?
What about the vision statement B?
I have no changes there.
Right, it seems like you can do neighborhood stuff.
No, within neighborhoods, but it doesn't mean that. And Kathy, you'll certainly remember this. A number of times I had raised issues for particular neighborhoods, for a particular neighborhood, my own Islington Creek, and was told flatly that we can't deal with individual issues. And that was very disappointing. I've worked very hard as a neighborhood rep for the Islington Creek neighborhood, and I brought their issues forward to this committee. And I would have liked to have the committee at least listen to and embrace some of the issues. And if the issues are without merit, then so be it. But if they have some merit to it, then let's see if we can address it. Now, we probably won't have very much going on until the end of this virus and until we have a vaccine. But this is a fundamental issue for us, for some of us, you know, and that's why I put it in there.
Larry, can I just say I understand. I think I understand what you're trying to do going forward. But Christy, you could back me up on this. I think that in the past we've always advocated for neighborhoods. I guess the difference, and I think maybe I'm wrong, just to try to summarize it. Is in the past, we have tried to make sure that neighborhoods had the tools to advocate for themselves, that they had all the information that they needed so they could go to the through the correct channels, and we would help them in any way. We didn't always stand up and say, hold a sign with them and go 100%, because that, like the issue that Larry's talking about with the parking program, the neighborhood parking program, it was also affecting, I was getting emails from other neighborhoods that didn't want that because it was going to affect their neighborhoods. So we were trying to play both sides, right or wrong, but I was still communicating with people and was totally willing to communicate with people to try to make sure that they were meeting with the correct people within the city. So I'm out of this. So whatever you want to do going forward is fine. But Christy, is that kind of how you see it?
Yeah. And one thing I would add is that part of that language was capturing the idea that if an avenue does not exist for a particular problem, that it's worth this committee's time to establish a city process or work with the city to make sure that their processes are available to whatever neighborhood down the line might have a similar problem. So if we use the parking permitting issue as an example, you know, if we were to have advocated for one neighborhood to get a parking permit program that solved their issues, and another neighborhood popped up a year from now and wanted something similar, but it was a one-off solution, it doesn't help other neighborhoods and it doesn't establish a city government that's responsive to all neighborhoods' needs. And it doesn't give citizens a voice to affect, solutions. So I think that's what that language was trying to capture, is that if the system is broken, we should advocate for fixing the system and creating an avenue and not trying to pick off one-off solutions that can't be repeated.
And just a quick example of that would be the sound barriers. So the sound barriers, we were helping a neighborhood advocate for sound barriers, but it got to the point that it shouldn't be just a neighborhood advocating for sound barriers. They can go to the state, but they're not gonna get the same reaction as if an elected official went to the state or city staff went to the state. So we assisted a process to go through. We fought for it, we wrote letters, we got people involved until there were staff people that part of their position was to advocate for sound barriers and keep tabs on that entire convoluted process. And then when another neighborhood needed sound barriers, there was already a process in place and somebody that already had the contact in the history. So that's kind of where we went. I don't know semantics wise how this changes what we're going to do, what you want to do with that. But that was part of our, I guess that's what we saw that we wanted to do.
Yeah. I think another good example is the derelict property issues.
Right.
Islington Creek was having a problem with a particular property, but there were other neighborhoods that were having similar issues with properties that weren't being maintained up to city code. So collecting a list of all of those properties, and then Larry, I believe you worked to help us identify which ones had been addressed and which hadn't several years later. But those are kinds of solutions that will benefit any neighborhood that has a similar issue going forward. And oftentimes a complaint is, oh, well, only the squeaky wheel or only someone who knows someone can get any help. And really that language is meant to bust that idea, is that you don't have to know somebody at City Hall, or you don't have to have, special compensation in order to get an issue fixed, that if there isn't an avenue, we'll work to try to make sure that there's an equal process for anyone who has a similar issue.
Okay, what I would like to say is we were in Islington Creek, we were frustrated to the point because we were promised by the city that this would happen. And then suddenly it appeared that we had very few friends. And I brought this to the committee. I kept them abreast. And when it came time for at least some sort of show of some support, it came down to the point that this was a particular neighborhood issue. The issue of how it affected other neighborhoods was not on the table at that time. What was on the table was it had nothing to do with this. It had to do with city employees, people who worked in the city parking in our neighborhood, and it became a huge problem. And we were very disappointed with the outcome. But the whole point is that at least we had a forum through me, but I was virtually ineffective on the committee because I couldn't go forward with it other than to keep everyone abreast of what was happening.
Because of something that was written here?
No, had nothing. Well, it also had to do with the rather than as opposed to as well as. So I was very very disappointed there. I agree with Christy that we had an opportunity to do special research on deterioration of properties, and I have used that several times. And I think that's the type of work that I certainly like to do, is dig into an issue like that. But the individual neighborhood of people as I found out from two of my own neighbors who had a problem with the diesel fuel, diesel engines and the fumes that came from it. I asked them specifically why they didn't come to the Citywide Neighborhood Committee. And they said, frankly, they didn't think that we could do anything. And I was absolutely, I understood that because I couldn't do very much myself through the committee, but they didn't. And Paul Mantle had told me also that there were a number of others who had decided that they wouldn't go to the Citywide Neighborhood Committee and even bring the issue up. That's where we began. We've always been for a particular neighborhood when there was a decent fight, if a fight was needed, and we want to advocate for them when necessary. And that's why I want to change the rather than to as well as. Would any of you others, would Mark or Dave like to sound off on this?
Well, I talked to Rick Bagstead, Mayor Bagstead, and he made it very clear when I signed up that he wanted to go back to the past way of where we have reps, Ward 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if I'm in Ward 4, so for example, Woodlands 110 houses, they have an association. So I call up the president of the association and say, I'm the Ward 4 rep for the Citywide Neighborhood Association. Anything that's going on in your neighborhood, let me know about it so I can bring it to the city meeting. Okay, that's pretty cut and dry. So if I walk up to Patriots Park and the Cedars and these other complexes and say to their management, do you have anything that you want to share with the city? Send me an email. And so I'm gathering information as a Ward 4 rep to bring to the city, okay, to start advocating. So this area of the city, Lafayette Road area, has a voice. And so that was made clear by Rick Bagstead. He wanted to go from the way they do it now to that system where it used to be that way. And so now we have a Facebook page in Allen Park, 352 households. Not everybody's on it, okay? But there's proactive groups when it comes to social issues. But when it comes to city issues, there's not a lot of movement going on unless it's in small, small groups. I happen to hear about it because I've been living in the neighborhood for 45 years. So that's the direction I hope this group goes, where I can look at each individual on the screen and say, oh, that's what's going on in Ward 2, and you share it, okay? And then we relate with each other.
That's great that Rick wants to do that. That's something that we had been trying to move to before because we've never broken it down into wards before. We have about 23 active neighborhoods in the city that participate in National Night Out. We have a citywide neighborhood map that is at the, it's outdated, and I'm admitting that it's outdated. So we've always been neighborhoods and never been wards. We, I don't know how long ago that was, Christy, that we did a lot of work on trying to get ward representation, and it was pretty much shot down. So that's a different way of doing things, and I'm not for it or against it, but that's not how it was ever done prior to this. We've never done ward representation.
Well, for one city council term, they took the step, what that ward representation was, because we have 9 councilors at large and none of them are assigned to, they don't run in a ward, they're all at large for the whole city, that oftentimes you'd have a city council that was comprised up of 9 members who live in 2 wards, or where the majority of them live in 1 ward. And you hear them talk about issues that have to do with that particular ward up at city council over and over again, because it's where they all live and where they, you know, shop and work and walk. And so the idea was that a city council member would volunteer to be the contact for a ward. So when we first breached the idea of a ward rep, it was a city councilor who would serve in that capacity. Like I said, it only happened for one council term, which is only 2 years. It's when we started the ward forums. So the idea was that city councilor would attend that ward forum, introduce themselves, try to open that channel of dialogue, so that they could, if there were issues, they could, you know, either come to a city council, come to a citywide neighborhood meeting and say, hey, listen, this is what I'm hearing from people who are not involved in citywide neighborhood committee about things that are happening in this ward. Again, that didn't take off.
Okay. What happened was it was just lost interest, and they didn't get very many calls from the ward. So it went, as you said, by the wayside. Let's see. Do we have Dave? Do you have any comments?
Yeah. Naturally, I'm going to be more familiar with issues in my particular neighborhood. I happen to live within the Frank Jones neighborhood in Ward 3. However, I really hope that I'm not hamstrung going forward such that I cannot potentially represent issues in other neighborhoods as well. I generally agree with the amendment that you're putting forth. And I feel like I should be able to raise specific issues, not just in my particular neighborhood or ward or in any part of the city for that matter. So, but I do appreciate too that it can be tricky with respect to, you know, if I'm pushing forth some particular item and it's at the detriment of some other neighborhood, then I think we need to manage that effectively.
Yeah, I quite agree with that. I think that is the key, because these things can get out of hand very quickly. They can get very political, so to speak. But nevertheless, I agree with the sentiment there. Let me see. Do we have? I know we have a couple of visitors here. Or I should say neighbors. If you just keep your remarks very simple, if you have any. Joan, would you like to make a comment?
Hi. No, I haven't been following what the Citywide Neighborhood Committee's been doing, but I saw that you had something coming up about Ward 3, so I just wanted to find out
that's fine.
What that's all about.
Thank you. And Andrew, I've seen some of your writing in social media, so.
Yeah, I guess I just wanted to I feel like some of the neighborhoods in the city are more ignored than others. And I'm guilty of that myself. So I wanted to see, especially with COVID going on, if there's anything I can do to help some of the other neighborhoods.
A very good point. Okay. And in that case, I think we have enough for if someone would make a motion. I will say one thing that both Paul Mantle and And Beth Mergerson has already, they've already said that they agreed with the changes that are being made. The other changes are administrative. They just make it easy. They allow us to appoint the secretary, and which tonight I am. The one or two may be interconnected with this, but essentially it's just clarification. So we've gone over it a number of times. Would someone offer a motion?
Larry, I'll offer that motion.
Okay. Someone second?
I'll second it.
Okay. For the committee only, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. One, two, three.
Three. Okay. Opposed? Okay, thank you. It passes.
No, I'm abstaining. So I'm just
abstaining.
I feel like I'm still on the fence. I don't know what some of these.
We can talk offline if you don't mind. But in any case, it's been enough time on this, and I wanted to get it out of the agenda. Now, with your permission, I'd like to move to the Ward 3 forum. And Lori, would you be kind enough to tell us what's going on?
Yes. I'm excited about it. So on September 30th at 6 o'clock, there's going to be a Zoom Ward 3 forum. If people has everybody been to one, or should I just describe it? It's really a wonderful process.
Dave, have you been to a Ward forum or Mark?
I have.
Yeah, I've attended a couple.
Oh, you have.
Okay.
You're doing a Zoom one. Okay.
We're going to do a Zoom one. It's really the only practical thing that we have. So what we have is a listing of, I'll just go over it. So we have the mayor is going to be coming, Rick Beckstead, Jim Splain, the assistant mayor, Karen Kennard, the city manager, Peter Rice, the DPW director, Robert Myrner, the chief of police, Todd Germain, the chief of fire department, Julia Walker is the director of planning, and I don't know that we have a city councilor at that moment.
Did our mayor say that he was coming?
Yes, all those people that I listed are coming.
Our mayor is a city councilor in that case. And
okay.
And Jim Splain also.
So if he does
represent Jim Splain,
he is from Ward 3, so that would be most convenient for him.
Okay. So yeah, so I just wanted to also say, we're going to get a press release that's going to be distributed to everybody, but I'm going to distribute it to you guys, to everybody here too. And it was just given permission to everybody can put it on any social media that they want and right. Advertise it.
Yeah, so, Kathy, how long ahead of time should we begin beating the drum?
For September 30th? I would do social media at the beginning of September, and then make sure you get two press releases in, one the week, 2 weeks before, and one the week of,
okay.
Or the week before. What night is the 30th on?
It's on a Wednesday.
A Wednesday. If you could get something in on that Monday.
Yeah, so it has to go into the the Herald on Friday.
So Larry, you're gonna send out a Ward 3 meeting Zoom.
Yes. There's going to be a link.
We're going to get one.
And then there's going to be a link on the page, which is, I know I was talking with Peter Still about it.
The date
and it's going to be online, and then everybody's going to be able to link into it. They can sign up for it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Will it be on YouTube or just, is it Zoom or, you know, is it like a city council meeting where it's
not Zoom? That's interesting. I don't know. I thought it was, maybe it's going to be channel. I don't know. You know what? I thought it was on Zoom.
Yeah.
We'll clarify it.
Peter, if you're listening, could you chime in, please?
Sure.
Oh, good.
Hi. All I'm in the background. I'm just helping host the meeting. I'm in the planning staff. I don't know that it's, if these are broadcast live, I'm sure it will be recorded and then posted to the city's website if it's not broadcast live that night.
Okay.
Lori, I would just check with, when you follow up with the city clerk's office, ask them about that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there a reason why it wouldn't be live?
If there's another meeting that night, Sometimes we have multiple meetings on a night, and the higher priority one takes precedence and is broadcast live, and then the others are recorded and then posted later to the YouTube channel.
Okay, thank you. Yep. We will.
Okay, so that will be an interesting forum because each speaker, usually the panelists come in and they talk for a short time.
Yeah.
And then they answer particular questions about what their presentation was. And so Peter's job will be probably a little more interesting. And then at the very end of the process, all the neighborhoods of people who are there would ask general questions of different people. I mean, it's fairly orderly, but we don't know whether there'll be a few or a lot, you know, just have no idea. This is the first time that we'll be Zooming a forum, maybe the last time.
Right. I was just going to say, and it's a great process that everybody, they get to roll out information and they get to get feedback instantly and we get our questions answered. And it's a wonderful process to see what's going on within the ward.
Very good. Speaking of questions, I sent, you all got the response from Peter Rice on all the issues that were raised at the last forum. And we'll continue to do that. And for Andrew and Joan, what we did is at the last forum, where we started out with the neighborhoods, and if there were any neighborhood complaints or problems with the city or the police department, we would as we had done in the past, take them directly to the appropriate departments. And we did get a response from Peter Rice. He answered almost all the questions, and I know the Chief Myrna had agreed to pay special attention to speeding problems in Echo Avenue and Hillside Drive and Woodlawn Avenue. And on Mark off of Ward 4, your area of Harding Road and McKinley Avenue, he said that he would put up the speeding signs. I don't know whether he's done that or not. If you'd be kind enough to check when school begins.
Doesn't yet. Not in McKinley, not yet.
Yes, oh, they're not up yet.
No.
Okay. When is school beginning? I'm a little bit.
I don't know. My son's in Stratham. So when's Portsmouth start? The September 9th or?
No, they start. It's September 9th, but it's only one day a week. So.
One day a week.
Okay. Mark, if they're not up early in September, let me know, and I'll get back to the chief.
Larry, just to clarify, actually 2 days a week, depending on your last name. So there will be, I think, 2 days, right?
Yeah, so there'll be 2 days of actually, and there will be kids going to school every day.
Right, and kindergarten, first grade.
Yes, kindergarten, first grade, and then anybody that has a IEP or needs extra help has the ability to go every day. So there will be traffic. It won't be the same traffic as what we've seen in the past. And they've also staggered the start times to school a little bit. Instead of everybody starting at, I think it was 8:20, they start at different times. So, but it will increase traffic in the morning, but it won't be the same as last September, probably.
Okay. Anyhow, Mark, I look to you to just follow up on that, especially in the Dundero school. And then we can get back to the chief if there's a problem. And Dave, if the speeding still continues, let me know, because we'll just go back. I'll call the chief and say, you know, there's still issues back there.
On the Tuesday after Labor Day, if, you know, I go down to McKinley and Harding all, you know, every day. So if it's not there, then I'll reach out to you.
Okay, good enough.
Because then it's a question of when you're going to put it up.
That's correct. That'll be... Wait, and if we get complaints, if we get things like that again, you can email me directly, and I'll be more than happy to bring them to the directors and the.
We had a minor complaint from I call it minor because, you know, the kids have been hanging out at Dondero School and they've been taking their water bottles and their plastic, their trash, and leaving it down. And somebody wanted to put up a receptacle, trash cans. Well, the urban forestry they remove their trash cans to take out only, you know.
That's right, yeah.
And so some of the people said no to trash cans because then the city's going to have to, you know, remove it. And then you have, you know, rodents at night, and it's a problem. What I brought up to the group that was ranting, and I call it ranting on the Facebook page, is to be proactive and start, you know, advocating for upgrading the surveillance system on the exterior of Don Darrow School so you can have more security and awareness on what's going down at the school, you know, after hours during the school year. So I don't know if that small group of parents is proactive enough to reach out to the school system. But I can reach out to that particular individual. That was 2 weeks ago to see if they started advocating and, you know, for changes with the security, upgrading the security system on Don Darrow. I mean, there's no violence down there. There's nothing being broken, but they do have a new, you know, playground system that they've been building. The PTA has been putting a lot of money into building these, you know, natural structures. So I think they're worried about, you know, somebody vandalizing those. So if this group of parents can reach out to the school board and find out if they can upgrade that surveillance system, I think that's something that hopefully people are working on as we speak.
That would be great. And if we can help in that capacity, yeah, if there's a real need for it, then let's help them to do that. I agree.
Can we give the school board a little bit of time?
Absolutely. No. Listen,
they have a lot going on right now. I just don't think that that's their priority.
Absolutely.
And you know what? You could have made a little plastic bottles aren't really a big security issue. So
no, and once they're, you know,
it's not going to be till November until things get all settled in with the schools. My son in Exeter is a senior year. They're going online. And then I told my son after 4, 5, 6 weeks, they're going to do a reevaluation with staff and maybe you can start going back to school. Portsmouth did something different, you know, 1 or 2 days a week. And, you know, so you're right. Everything has to get settled in before you talk to the school.
Absolutely, yeah. And even on the speed things, a couple of weeks extra to make sure everything settles down probably wouldn't hurt either. Let me move on, if anyone doesn't object, to National Night Out.
Larry, I just have one quick
thing.
My question with respect to the Ward 3 forum. If this turns out to be a Zoom meeting, will the distribution be limited and restricted to just Ward 3 residents, or can anyone from any other ward potentially join that Zoom as well?
Well, those ward meetings are public meetings.
Okay. They are indeed.
Okay, good. I just want to double check.
Anybody can attend.
Okay. I've been to Ward 4 meetings where people from Ward 3 are there asking.
Yeah, I just wasn't sure given the, you know, the technology being used, you know, were we just sending out invites to certain?
Listen, if Peter can and others like him can hold a city council meeting with all the people there in the sidelines, then I think this one will probably go very smooth.
No, I wasn't concerned about the load, more in terms of just how are we getting the word out. I mean, to non Ward 3 residents, and
it will go out to the entire city. Newspaper. It'll go into. I usually put it into neighborhood. I put it into the city web, the city social media site, and I get it into other sites as well. And of course, Mark, you may have a couple other sources, but we'll all have an opportunity, as Lori said, to send these things out. And to send them out on a wide distribution. The city website, the Portsmouth, I forget what they call it, there's so many. The official Portsmouth website has over, I think, 2,000 people on it right now. Our own website has about maybe 200. Our mailing list is about 200. And some of them are city officials and elected officials. If you don't mind, I'll move on to National Night Out, and then we'll move to the next item. National Night Out, I had reached out to Chief Myrna over a month ago and talked to him for a bit, and he said that he was interested in maybe having two of his officers work with us on National Night Out. I sent a follow-up email, and Lori, thank you very much. She sent a reminder out today, and we really haven't heard very much from them. But I will share with you, and so I'm in limbo because this is their National Night Out is part of the police department's own thing, and we haven't heard from them. I'm sure we will downstream, but I can share with you several things. First, I did get an email from the National Night Out headquarters in Pennsylvania, and they had an idea that's very similar that they were passing around. The police department of Richardson, Texas, have what they call a drive-through. And so the idea is to show that law enforcement, I should say, police officers were people, and they would go to various neighborhoods and introduce themselves, much like they did in the forums when we had neighborhoods parties and neighborhood picnics. However, they wouldn't. They would just go to different neighborhoods and get out of their vehicles and say hello and do whatever else they have to do, what they call greet residents. And some of the people who would accompany them could be city council members. They also were promoting the idea of decorating front yards, having picnics in front yards on that particular day, light bulbs turned on, porch lights turned on at night, and even porch lights with blue in them turned on at night. And so those are some general ideas that they had that they promoted. Now, I don't know what Portsmouth Police Department wants to do. I'll reach out to them again. And all we know is that we certainly wouldn't support a neighborhood party or a neighborhood gathering, and neither does the National Night Out people. So that's as far as I can go with this. I want to go further, and Laura, you've been very helpful there. We just have to maybe wait another week or two, but it's getting along. And Kathy, it's going to be October 6th that they're planning National Night Out. The chief has something in mind, but apparently the officers are busy, and they just haven't gotten back to me at all. So that's all I have to report on that particular issue. Anyone else have anything to say about that?
Yeah, I just wanted to just mention too, is that when it's typically held in August, we have plenty of daylight to have something in the evening hours after people are done with their work day. October 6th, the sun will be setting a little after 6 p.m.
Yes.
So your daylight hours to even have a drive-by event will be somewhat limited during that time frame to catch families after their work day is done.
I mean, you have a very good point. It may well be, as I talked to the chief, that they may not want to do anything this year and pass it off the next year. And if that's what they want to do, okay. I mean, that'd be their decision. But if they want us to help them, then on something like a drive-by would have to be in during the day, and would have to be organized through the neighborhood representatives based on the list that I had from last year. At least certain locations could be coordinated. And I think that's probably as far as we could go on that. Unless they take the lead, we just have to wait and see. All right, anybody have anything else on National Night Out? Then let's go to, are there any urgent neighborhood issues that we'd like to discuss at this time?
I wanted to just bring something up for Mark, just in response to the issues at the school that they're seeing. You know, we've had similar things in the Heights around the ball field when it's not Little League season, when you get kids sort of using the area behind the field as a hangout spot where they're littering or where the trash cans are getting overrun and that sort of thing. And we've had a lot of success when we weren't able to either work with the Little League because they were in recess and weren't able to respond, or that the city, you know, was tied up with other things, just organizing neighbors to go in and do a cleanup. We would do like an Earth Day cleanup or something of that area just to deal with the immediate problem of the trash. And then when we were able to talk to either the city or the Little League, we would be able to lead with the, hey, we organized this to help you because we knew you couldn't get to it then. And it was just a nicer way to sort of approach a problem than 50 phone calls about trash. And they were much more responsive to sort of that tactic of saying, oh, you know, we organized a cleanup because we noticed it was getting abused when you weren't around. And so things like that seem to help. And if people are bothered by the trash, it gives a proactive maybe event to get some neighbors to get together, especially with their kids not being in school full time.
Yeah, I think that's more responsive. I'll reach out to the particular individual versus through a Facebook message, because that's how I communicate with her, and introduce a cleanup before school starts. And then find out what she has done proactively to, you know, whether either cameras or putting out some kind of notices. It's mainly the kids that go up to Cumberland Farms and they get their snacks and then they ride their bikes and they hang out. But it's not really a big problem. I think the hypersensitivity, which is, I can understand, is that the PTA at Dondero has put a lot of time and money into raising. So if you go down to Dondero, they're going from a traditional ball field to this all natural playground. And it's kind of different. It's kind of neat. There's mixed views on it in the neighborhood, or at least in Owen Park and Ward 4, or Dondero parents. So that group is sensitive to, you know, vandalism. Is someone going to break it? Trash cans. But we don't have trash down there. But I'll reach out to that and maybe organize something with the city in that small group and saying that before school starts. And I don't know, I got to also find out if they're using that field for any kind of elementary school soccer or anything. It's been a very wet field over the years. So there's some issues there that I'm curious to see how parents feel that kids are going there, that K-5 group. That's a good idea. I'll share that. Organize a cleanup. I encourage everybody to go down there. It's different. If anybody's ever seen a natural structure, playground, to drive by it and take a look, they have they planted trees and it's kind of, it's different. I mean, I'm old school. I want to see a baseball field and, you know, but.
The slide that burns you on the way down.
Slides for each other way down.
Okay. Andrew, would you like to make any comments? Or Joan? Andrew? Before we close the meeting, no? Joan, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm good. Thank you for letting me listen in.
I hope you both of you show up. And we have a Jean Merrill. If Jean is there, if she wants to make a comment, she can. Okay. Without further ado, then we'll close the meeting. We'll keep the forum information. We'll make sure everyone's get in touch with them. And if there's any new changes on National Night Out, I'll keep all of you informed, and which would be quite natural. Okay. So with that, I'd like to close the meeting and thank you all for participating. Kathy, thank you for joining, and Christy, we appreciate having your input. I really do. Thank you.
Nice to see you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Peter, for putting this on. Okay, take care.
You're welcome.
And stay safe. Yep. Okay, bye-bye.